Hello roller skate revivers, I'm Mickey, and in this video I'm going to take you from start to finish of how I just mounted these Wifa Street Extreme boots to my old Sunlite plates. I just finished it just now. And if you've ever seen any of my videos, some of this might be repetitive because I go over my mounting process, my mounting philosophy, so you might already know some of this, or even if you know some of this already from some other source, you know, then I have chapters and you can just skip it. But my intention is to fill you with so much information that if this is the only video you watch, once you're finished with this, you are ready to mount a setup just like this yourself. And I know it's kind of scary sometimes, you know, you bought your dream boots and you're worried that you're gonna mess it up, but don't worry, you can do this. You just need to know some things and, you know, focus and breathe, and you've got this, you do. And then me from the future, I will come back after I've had a chance to skate on these for a couple of weeks, and I will give my feedback as far as what I think about them, and I hope I will be able to collect feedback from other people so that you can get a better sense of whether you should be building a setup like this for yourself. Hi, this is Mickey from the future, and this video did end up being really super duper long, but I think I'm gonna keep it all in. So if you want to know this information, but I end up talking about something that you don't care, that's fine. I really invite you, when you're twitching, to write like a negative comment about how boring I am, just skip to the next chapter. You don't have to tell me, I don't care. This is my channel, so I can put on it whatever I want, and if you don't like it, I invite you to watch any of the literally other millions of videos that are on YouTube, which you are using to watch this right now.
You grab the skates and I'll grab the tools. Let's go rolling around like a couple of fools. Don't care if we're old, let's start something new. Let's go rolling around, me and you.
Before I get too far into this video, I want to acknowledge two things. One of them, I did get a lot of advice from Adrienne Schreiber of Department of Skate in the US. She's done a lot of Wifa mountings over the past couple years, and as far as I can tell, she's kind of like the English language Wifa expert. So I've done a lot of mounting myself, but I haven't done as many high-heeled mounts, and this is my first time mounting a Wifa boot, so I asked her a lot of questions about her feedback, her advice, so on and so forth. So I might not always remember to say, oh, Adrienne said blah, 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 blah. But just so you know, I did lean quite heavily on her for this video. So if you have any questions, she would be a very good person to ask. Another disclosure is that I got these beautiful boots for free.
Sellout! You're a sellout!
Yes, I am a sellout. I got free boots that I was going to buy anyway. And I'm spending a bunch of hours, you know, recording this video to earn them. So I contacted Wifa and said, hey, you know, I would like to have some of these boots. If you send me a complimentary pair, I will record the whole video of, you know, me mounting them, blah, 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 blah. And if you don't want to do that, that's fine. I will just pay money for my boots and I will not record it. I do like to share this with the community because sometimes, you know, you get the impression that people think that mounting skates is like black magic, like you need a PhD for it.
I shall perform this miracle.
I've never believed in miracles. I've even forgotten how to pray.
And you don't. You do need to know some things. You need to be careful so that you don't destroy something expensive. And you do learn a lot from trial and error. So by all means, if there's somebody that if there's a shop nearby or someone you know that you can have do it, that's great. But if you don't, you know, it's not like you can't do it yourself. You can. And so I want to make this video to help you if you are in that position where you would like to do it yourself, but you don't know where to start or who to ask. So why did I want to get a Wifa boot? Well, look at it, it's beautiful. A lot of people started skating during the pandemic. Welcome to the club. I'm very happy to have you. This is the best hobby as far as I'm concerned. Welcome to the cult. But there are also new companies that came about, and with anytime you do something new, there's a little bit of trial and error, and Wifa's been around since the 1920s. So while they are new to the whole like street skating, park skating scene, they have been making good skate boots for 100 years. They just need to tweak a little bit to make it exactly what we want. They're not trying to learn everything all over again, so I think it's a good company to go with. Additionally, for Europeans, it's just right around the corner. They're in Austria and I'm in Germany. So it's super expensive for us to ship, for example, a high quality Rydell boot to Europe, but the Wifa ones are both cheaper initially and then also cheaper to get to. So I have really high hopes about being able to use the shit out of these Wifas. I don't always remember to say this, but when I'm talking about my particular skating, it's almost always skate park skating. Like street skating, I don't know anything about, you know, jam skating, JV, etc. So if I have not only are my opinions my own, but they're also my own about this particular realm. Who is this not for? If you have, so the reason why I wanted to get these boots is because I have a slightly wide foot, and these are a little bit wider as far as I've heard than a lot of the high heel boots. But if you have a very narrow foot, or if you have like, you know, one long toe and then the other is tapered down quite a bit, then you're gonna have a lot of extra space. And so this is something that Adrienne told me from Department of Skate, is that those people are the people that tend to not be as happy with them, but the opposite, you know, the slightly wider foot or the people who want a little bit more space, these people are very happy with Wifa boots. Something else to know is that sometimes these are described as like a soft artistic boot, but I heard that that's actually significantly softer than an artistic boot. If you are like a lifestyle or a park skater, then this will probably feel very firm and, you know, like stiff and strong to you. But if you are accustomed to a very, very firm, like artistic style boot, then you will think this is too soft. So I made reference to the COVID pandemic a couple of times, talking about new skaters taking up skating during the pandemic and new companies that came up, you know, during the same time. And speaking of the pandemic, there is something I wanted to mention, which is that I started this channel at that time and I called it Roller Skate Revival because I felt like every time I read an article about roller skating in that period, they used that term and I felt like it was so much of a cliche, and so I was kind of making fun of it, like how when I played roller derby, I felt like every single article I read was like secretary by day, superstar by night, and so in this period, every single article I read was like Roller Skate Revival. So I wanted to kind of make fun of that, the lazy journalists using the same term all the time, and also to show people that they could revive old gear, because I knew that there, you know, people were on these like several month long waiting lists to get skates, when I knew that also like eBay and Craigslist had them, but maybe you would have to do some stuff to revive it. But what I did not know at the time is that term, like when people use roller skate revival, what they're doing is they're bulldozing over, for example, in the US Black community, roller skating never stopped, you know, so you can't revive something that never died, right? Like you can't discover land that people live in.
We stole countries with the cunning use of flags. Yeah. You just sail around the world and stick a flag in. I claim India for Britain. And they go, you can't claim us, we live here. 500 million of us. Do you have a flag?
By trying to make fun of this cliche of like roller skate revival and like lazy journalists, it almost sounds kind of like colonizing roller skating, like just because white people stopped doing it, you know, it went away or something. And that's really not what I meant at all. I was just trying to make fun of lazy cliches and try to help people skate now. You know, instead of waiting for their perfect skates, they could be like, you know, skating, making friends, going outside, exercising tomorrow instead of 6 months from now. So I apologize if for unwittingly being a part of the bulldozing, you know, the whitewashing of the of roller skate history. So I hope that just now you were like, shut up, everybody knows this, and you were super bored. But if you were like, mind blown, you know, had no idea that there was so much history with roller skating in the US and Black culture, then I would highly recommend you look up the documentary, the HBO documentary called United Skates. It has a lot, it goes through the whole history, it shows a lot of really interesting things that I didn't even know, like, you know, Salt and Peppa performing at rinks. And it really just showcases some amazing skating and styles that maybe you're not aware, I wasn't aware of at least. So I would very highly recommend you stop this video right now and go find it and then come back. Taking your plates off of existing roller skates is not terribly difficult. You just need a couple of tools. But I did make a video on how to do that where I took some plates off of an R3 and I recorded the whole process, talked about it. So if you feel nervous about that, I will put a link to that below and you can watch me doing that. I'm sorry, I took these off a long time ago, so I didn't record it. But there are two notes that I wanted to draw attention to. One of them is that because I'm using a Sunlite plate, I love Sunlites. They're really strong and really cheap, and I love that they also come in lots of colors. But the thing that I don't like about Sunlites is that the toe stop tends to fall out after a while. Fortunately, that is a very easy problem to solve. You can go to a hardware store and you can either get larger lock nuts like this or a split washer. You don't need to do both of these things. I usually do one or the other. All you need to know is that the correct size is 5/8 inches, and if you're going to use something with threads like this, then it needs to be 18 TPI. If this doesn't have any threads, it's just size. So in that case, if you're going to get a split washer like this, then you just need to know 5/8 of an inch. And if you get those from a typical hardware store, they don't cost very much, and it solves the problem of toe stops falling out of your sunlights. The other thing that I want to draw attention to is I made also a video. I like to flip around my kingpins so that this is flat so I can grind. Oh, I can't grind, I'm not very good at it, but theoretically I can grind. The other solutions that people will do is sometimes they will file down their kingpin, or sometimes they will use like an angle grinder, and those are also fine. I didn't want to do that, so I flipped it around. And I don't think that you can do that with every plate though, because some plates have more specialized parts for their kingpin, but with the Sunlite, it's basically just a hex bolt. So that was quite easy to do. I have another video about how to do that. So with quad skates, there are basically two styles of mounting as far as like where you're gonna place it. There's a center mount and there's an offset mount. And the center mount is more of a straight line, and you'll see it more in line with like the center of the front of the boot. And that is used more for it's more like ice skating or like inline skates, and that makes it easier to go in a straight line. But an offset mount is when they put it to the side a little bit, usually like 2 or 3 millimeters off, and the goal is to put the center of the axle in between like the second and the third toes and the ball of the foot. And that is more efficient for power transfer, so it's easier to go faster if you're using that. So you'll see this a lot with like speed skates or with derby skates. If you bought some skates from the manufacturer and you don't know whether you have a center mount or a offset mount and you want to see, one way you can tell is if you hold your skates up like as straight as you can to look at them from the top down. If you can see more of your wheels on the inside than the outside, then you probably have a center mount. Whereas if you can see them pretty much 50-50 on each side, then you probably have an offset mount. My slaves, which you can see that I wear them on really shitty days. I have not been taking very good care of these. But these are more of a center mount. There's more like in the middle here, and I don't know if I'll be able to show you, hold this straight, but basically when you're staring down, you see more wheels on the inside than the outside. And my Park Stars are not completely comparable because they have wide trucks, so you can see more of the wheels in general. But if I try to hold it straight, then it looks pretty much 50-50 on each side. And when you look at it from here, you can see that it's kind of more pointed out towards this side than the slades are. So what I'm going to do when I'm mounting this is I'm going to put tape on all the areas that I expect to mark. And then I am going to measure the widest part of the foot, which is probably right about here, but I'll have to measure a little bit to see which is the widest part, and get the middle, and I'm going to mark the middle of this and the middle of that and draw a line, and then I'm just going to grab my plate and do a bit of a sanity check to see if that line lines up with what I would expect to have the middle of the axle like under the second and the third toe. And the other thing to think about is that I'm going to want to have the axle, and what I mean by that is this part, I want to have that under the ball of my foot where I put my weight, like when you're tiptoeing and you're standing on the ball of your feet. That's where you're going to also put your weight when you're leaning to skate. And so I want to have the axle of my truck either directly under that or maybe a little bit in front, but definitely not behind. And the back part, I don't really care about that as much. It's mostly just that if I want to be able to control myself well with the axles under the ball of my feet or maybe a little bit in front. Another side note is the heeled boots, and I think this is true about Moxies and also like these Wifas, is that they're kind of narrow, but the Sunlite is really wide. So I will almost definitely have some amount of overhang, you know, like here or maybe in the front. And it's just cosmetic. You know, what's important is where the trucks are in relation to your foot. It's not really important where this little lip is. Side note, there is something to know. I think I mentioned it already, that the heel is very narrow, so on a lot of plates you're going to have some overhang, and I'm pretty sure I mentioned in this video that I think it's cosmetic and not that big a deal. Yeah, certainly it's not. It does take away from the beauty of the mounting, but I don't think it's a functional problem. I got in a discussion online with one of those really persnickety mounting conversations, which I typically tend to avoid the mounting discussions online because I think they tend to make a big deal out of nothing, and it's just a waste of time. But I thought it was amusing that somebody said that he thought that the overhang was an ankle hazard. And I was like, how do you expect an ankle to get in there really? Like, I put the narrow plates, I put the narrow trucks back on here to try to see like where the ankle would have to be. And he's like, oh yeah, there could be like an ankle hazard, or like you could cut someone's cheek. I'm like, I don't, like, I'm hitting my head on here before I'm actually getting my cheek here. I don't know what kind of pileup he's expecting to happen, or like how my ankle is gonna get in there. But yeah, I really don't think that that's the biggest problem. Let me know if you accidentally cut your ankle or your cheek on an overhanging plate, and I will take it back. The other thing that Adrienne told me is that notice there are a bunch of screws in here, and I might have to remove them. I'm gonna just mark where I wanna drill and see how it goes, and if I need to remove them, I might need to pause to fill it with some epoxy resin or something, just to make sure that I'm reinforcing the strength of the sole. But hopefully I won't have to do that, because that would be a lot easier if I can just skip this whole step. Hello again. So I forgot to tell you the reason why I like to mark tape on my boots. And that's because mounting does give me some degree of anxiety. And so I usually change my mind a couple of times about where exactly I want to drill the holes. And so you can see here that I actually put on several pieces of tape because I changed my mind several times about that hole. And so instead of having lots of marks all over my boots and confusing myself by being like, is this the first hole or the second hole or the third hole? I know that I can just put tape over it, and then whatever hole is the most obvious, because that's where the tape is the hole that I want to drill. I mean, so here I'll show you that my lines from when I marked, this is approximately the widest part, and here's where the center was, and then making the line from the center here to here, and then I'm kind of placing putting the plates on here to identify where I want to drill the holes. And I'm always careful, but I'm being extra careful because Adrienne told me that the wood on the soles is extra unforgiving, so you need to really make sure that you get it in the right spot. So I'm going over this a lot. And something else I forgot to mention is that I will be using some toe wedges, because you can see that the boot has a lot of space right here. And I mean, you can mount without it. You just, you know, pull extra hard and kind of make the boot conform. Even this is, you know, is a little small, like it could stand to be bigger. Maybe I could have gotten like a friend with a 3D printer to make me one, but I'm just going to use these IDEA toe wedges that you could probably find at a skate shop. If they don't have one at your typical like skate park derby skate shop, find someone that caters to artistic skaters, because this is pretty common for like IDEA, Resport, and Rollline. So if you find a shop, even if they don't have it on the website, because maybe not very many people order this, they probably know what you're talking about if you ask for toe wedges. And you can, I think I paid like $3 or something, not very much at all. So yeah, I am spending my evening deciding exactly where to put these holes. Side note, I wouldn't be surprised if somebody from the peanut gallery right now is saying, oh, that plate's way too big. And of course, wheelbase is a personal preference. Wheelbase refers to the distance between the axles on the same side, so like between here. And that is a personal preference. It's both like dependent on you and also how you want to skate and like what type of skating you want to do. For example, when I played roller derby, I always wanted to have a shorter wheelbase, typically like 140 millimeters, 150 millimeters, because it makes you more agile. So on a short track like roller derby, you want to move around more. But, you know, like raise your hand if you've ever been at a skate park and felt somebody saying, wow, I really wish I could turn more sharply. I really wish I could have made that sharp turn. I've never heard that. Normally people are more focused on jumping higher, on landing their moves, on staying on their wheels. And for that, you would want a longer wheelbase. So I'm really pushing it. I have the longest thing that will possibly fit on this boot. I don't remember exactly what it is. It's maybe like 175 or something, maybe even 180. So I ended up taking the toe wedge and just taping it on the plate and cutting off the edges a little bit and then drilling a hole in it, because the holes it has already are for how a roll line boots plates will be, not for Sunlites. But I mean, it doesn't really matter that there's already holes here. This isn't for strength. It's just for like a little bit of stability, a little bit of support. And I think that I have decided where to drill the holes in my boots. But in fact, since I've been doing this for a while today, I'm worried that I would do something hasty because I'm tired and want to be done. So I'm going to leave this, and I'm going to take another look at it tomorrow when I'm a little bit more like freshly coffeed and breakfasted. Tools for this job are a drill, some drill bits. I have some short ones that I start with and then I extend to the long ones. I start with a small drill bit and then work my way up. and you will need a countersink. I'll explain when I do it. And I also just use a sharp, like a nail or a screw to kind of push in some pilot holes, just so I can know where my drill is gonna go. A regular screwdriver, the same size as the screws, the mounting screws you're gonna use. A right angle screwdriver is not necessary, but it is really helpful to hold it in place in the boot, really for Vans mounts, because the laces don't go all the way to the toe. You don't need it as much for something like a Wifa boot, but it's still nice to have. And I ended up actually using this to, well, you'll see in the video why I use this. and then either a small wrench or a back mount spanner. You don't need both of these, but one of them at least. And then the mounting hardware that I ended up using were M5. I always use M5 unless it's a roll line plate. And it is 60 and 30 for the front. I could have done 25, but 60 was definitely the right size. And then some washers and some lock nuts. If you get nuts from the hardware store, please make sure that you get the kind with some nylon. Otherwise, if you don't have the nylon, they will fall off eventually, and I say that from experience. And then just two wheels with bearings in them as a quick sanity check to try to see how much is poking out on each side before I drill to make sure that I actually do have this in the right spot. So it's been a couple of days. As I said, you don't really need to do it all in one day. It's really, lots of times I'll start something and then finish it a couple days later. For me, it's important that I be like ready and in a clear headspace before I'm going to put holes into a $300 boot than it is for me to finish all in one day. So before I actually put the holes in, what I like to do is take just two wheels that have the bearings in and put them on the front truck so I can test to make sure that I'm seeing equal amount of wheels on both sides. I just like to do a quick sanity check one more time before I actually put holes into the boot. So if I carefully line this up with the holes that I marked, you tell me, does it look even to you? If you have a drill press, those are pretty amazing because you can basically just line up your boot, you know, check it, recheck it, check it again, and then just kind of like this, and you have your holes. But I do not have one of those, access to those right now, so I just use like a sharp little wood screw, and I'm just putting a little indentation so that I can find it later with my drill to make sure that it's in the right spot. And that is something that Adrienne told me, is that the wood is very unforgiving, so really, really, really check to make sure you're drilling in the right spot. I forgot to mention, I like to start with my skinniest bit and then slowly work my way up. It's too much commitment to drill one big hole at once. You're probably looking at the window and thinking, wow, what a weirdo, she drills at midnight. But no, it's Germany at like 5 p.m. Well, I don't know what all these orange bits are on the drill, but I did make it in. Good. And with narrow-heeled boots, it's always kind of hard to make sure that you go inward enough that you can still fit the countersink in without getting the inner boot liner. And it looks like I just barely made that. It's always very stressful. So when I was doing this hole, it went through every, for some reason, this one was really easy, and then this one I had to kind of push really hard, and there was just, there were like some little screw bits that fell out, or rather nail bits, and a lot of sawdust actually. When I was going like this, it was like, and it went through everything except for the very last layer of the insole, so I grabbed a really skinny screwdriver and kind of pushed at it from the other side to make the last, like, you know, the last bit of the hole connect. Be really careful that you don't push really hard and end up destroying the internal liner, so that you have to be kind of delicate, even though it's hard to do sometimes. And now I'm going to use the countersink, because otherwise You would be sitting on top of this mess, and you don't want that. You want to be able to countersink it so that your screws will lay flush and you will not feel it under your feet. I forgot to mention, I always countersink just a little bit at a time, and then from time to time I'll stop and I'll check and I'll try to put one of the screws I'm going to be using in to see when to stop, because the thing is, you can always do more, but you can't take it back after you. So if you've done too much, then your screw is going to sink too far and you could risk having the screw go through the boot. So don't do that. Always do a little bit, check, a little bit, check. So now I'm going to do the same thing again. I'm not going to record it because you don't need to see the same thing twice, and I will see you again when it's time to put the plate on the boot. So eventually you are going to need to use basically a screwdriver to hold the screw in to keep it from spinning, and then a wrench to tighten it. If you only use the wrench, then probably the screw will continue to spin and you won't really be doing anything. Something that can be really useful when mounting skates is to have a right angle screwdriver like this, so that you can hold the nut in place while you are tightening it from the bottom without having to use a screwdriver and kind of trying to get it straight. It's important that you not twist the screwdriver, because then if it's not really tightly into the screw, then you risk stripping the screw. And if your screw is stripped, it will be really hard to get it out later if you ever want to change plates or something. So you want to avoid that at all costs. Unfortunately, I think all I have is this one. It's too big. I think I might have let somebody borrow mine, so I won't be using it in this video, but I wish I were. I ended up using a 30 millimeter in the front and a 60 millimeter long screw in the back. The 60 looks about perfect. The 30 is a little bit too long. I think 25 would have been okay. The thing you need to think about if you're gonna say whether these screws are too long or not is if they're going to hit my wheel. Since I use wide trucks, this is basically an impossibility. It just bothers me because it would look nicer if it were a little bit shorter. If you don't want to have boxes and bags of screws like I do, then you could just buy the typical mounting gear, mounting set, or you could just buy a lot of really long ones, like maybe just a box of 60s, and then cut them off. You can either use like a Dremel with a saw attachment. I don't like to do that because I don't like sparks flying at my face, but it's a perfectly fine thing to do. Or SureGrip sells this bolt cutting tool that's basically just a thick metal straw that you would like put in there and wiggle around and it'll come off. And either one of those, after you do it, you are going to need to hit it with a hammer a little bit so that you don't have sharp edges, because otherwise maybe if you touch your skates, you're going to cut yourself. I mean, this is fine, but you could also do it the other way. It's personal preference, just as long as it's not going to touch the wheel or cut you. Finished! First impressions from the mounting were actually that drilling into the heel was really hard. I'm kind of strong, but actually by the end I was really pushing in with my strength, not just letting the drill do the work. So that was a little bit surprising, but it worked out all right. Putting them on, for some reason, the left is really comfortable. It's very firm, but very secure. My right ankle doesn't like something here, but maybe I have an irregular foot because my left foot is perfectly happy. But I will just skate on them and see how they feel. What do you guys think though? Should it be the turquoise laces or the white laces? So it's been about a month. I've skated on these, I don't know how many hours, I want to say 15-ish, maybe 20. At first they were so opposite, well they are so opposite from what I've been on all year. I've been on Bont Park Stars. And so at first I was like, wow, these feel so different. It's been such a long time since I skated on heels, I forgot how different it feels. So for example, this year I've been doing a lot of power slides. Loudest power slide on all the things has been the theme of the year, and I was really shocked that I couldn't, because it's so firm in the ankle, I actually couldn't bend my ankle at all. So I had to kind of readjust my thinking, like new boot, new skating style, right? It's not like you can do all the same things in different parts of your gear. That's why you change up here to see how it changes. So that is the thing that I noticed most, is the difference in ankle mobility, and it's a little bit like two sides of the same coin. People think the bonds are firm, but they're not really that firm, or maybe because these are old, I don't know. But I mean, I have a lot of ankle freedom. And so on these, they're very firm. So at first I was like, oh my god, I can't bend my ankle, ah! But then a counterpoint is, for example, there was one day where I was working on cartwheels a lot, and so my ankles were quite sore. I was working on cartwheels in the Park Stars. And then for the next week or two, my ankles were very sore because there was a lot of impact on my ankles. So when I was skating, I skated in these and I had no pain at all because they're very protective and very strong. And so I felt like the Wifa was doing the work for me. And maybe if I had been working on cartwheels on these in the first place, then I probably wouldn't have hurt my ankle at all. Wifas in the bowl, they actually kind of throw me in the air more. And when I noticed that, I was like, oh, weird. Then I put on my Park Stars. And I could still kind of jump, but I felt like I had to generate that momentum from myself, whereas these ones just kind of do it. I don't know, I lack the technical knowledge to know why, but it feels like there's a lot more shock absorption in these. There was, you know, my local skate park, there's this one part that's really rough asphalt, and I hate skating over it because I usually have very rough wheels, I mean, very hard wheels, which make it kind of like that unpleasant foot massage. And so there was a time when I was going to skate over it and I was wearing these and it was nothing. It was fine. It was like, you know, I mean, I could tell that it wasn't like smooth, but there was no problem with it. And similarly, I live in Berlin, Germany, and then we often have like these cobblestone streets and I hate skating over them. Usually it's like a race against falling and sometimes you make it out without falling and sometimes you're not so lucky. And so a while ago I was wearing these and I saw that that was coming up and I was like, oh God, this is going to be horrible. And it was fine. And so again, I think that's another way of like two sides of the same coin, you know, because for example, I thought that I wanted these for street skating, but actually sometimes I feel like I'm less sensitive, like I don't really know what's under my feet. And so I think I actually still like to be a little more sensitive for street skating. But on the other hand, like this is a lot more, again, like doing the work for you for unideal street conditions. So I think that that is very subjective. Different people might have different opinions of that. And so speaking of different people and different opinions, I asked a couple friends to give their reviews. One of them is my friend Camila. She has smaller feet than me, so she has her own set of Street Extremes. And then I have a couple friends that have the same size feet as me, so I asked them to try them on and give them some feedback and let me record it.
That's better.
I'm glad let's start over.
Okay. Hi, I'm Camila, and I'm wearing this Wifas for 5 months.
Which ones are these? Are they the
Street Extreme.
Okay.
And I like them, but for me, they should be a little bit lower cut, and they could have a little bit more movement around here.
That's why you don't lace them all the way, because it's a little bit too much.
Yes, heat. Yes. I like how they respond, the boot responds really well when you're moving. I don't want to run over the insect. So the boot responds really well, but and it's like nice and supportive, so you feel also very comfortable inside. But they are too high and too hard, way up high on the leg.
And you're using them mostly for ramp skating or what?
Yeah, I tried a bit of street skating with them too, but I really feel the need to have more mobility for other stuff. But for the ramps, it's nice. It's fine. Especially for carving. Yeah. Yes. Yes, that's it, I think. I ruptured my ligaments like three times, so I really like very high and stiff skates.
Yeah, okay.
But so I can imagine that those are super hard.
Did you try mine on?
Yeah.
And what did you think about it?
I bought the wheels. they were too small, so I can't really judge a lot, but they are super stiff. So, but they are also were super new, so maybe they will get softer.
No.
No.
They are exactly the same.
I like
since
how they
I
fit.
Started.
So if they were like a one size bigger, they would have fit perfectly. Yeah. I like how they are supporting your arch a lot.
That's amazing.
That's amazing. But they were just a little too stiff for me.
Yeah.
The boot is nice and firm, so it is a little hard to squat. Yeah. It is manageable, and it possibly would get better, I think. But I mean, the stiffness is nice because it gives you stability and it feels very stable. I like the look, and I also like how my foot sits in there.
This is just insane.
you want black?
You can try whatever you want.
No, I'm just gonna go. I guess.
Go ahead, what do you like?
So first of all, I really like that they have less hooks than the other street ones that I have. So they had like hooks all up, I think, there.
Mm-hmm. You mean compared to like a Adea or Resport type?
Yeah, I don't know, not really. I was like comparing it to the other ones mm-hmm. that have more hooks or something. Mm-hmm. So those are actually better. And I don't understand that one though. Like zero understanding.
I never use that one in either this coming up. What?
I do like them. I do like how they feel. Especially in this area. Here. They're really good. And I don't find them too bad up here. It's like, obviously for dancing, not perfectly. But for skating in the streets and stuff, I like them. They're too high here. So this is painful here, this part. But here is really nice. It could be a little, have a stiffening here in the toe area. There's nothing. There's no counter. But otherwise, I would actually skate them. It's just that the missing counter in the toe area that actually makes you lose any force on your toes. Like every time I like push on my toes, it just like bends the leather. But other than that, I feel very secure, I would say.
So you said you would use them for trail skating, or what would you
say? Yeah, I think for like outdoor skating, you don't lose too much power. I mean, especially if they had the counter in the front, you would even lose less power, but for the back, it's nice, steady. You can also jump. Thank you, neighbors. yeah, I think they're actually kind of good. I don't know if for ramp skating, like, I don't know. Like, I think the cut-in part here for ramp skating is problematic for me. Could be a little lower, maybe 1 centimeter, or especially this one a little more rounded. Yeah, other than that, I think they're great.
So there's Leah, iPower Girl, on Instagram, and she has the same exact boot as me. So when I met her, I was like, wow, we're boot buddies. I would say that her style of skating is definitely the kind of person that should be on something like the Wifa Street Extremes, because she does a lot of big power moves like jumps and flips and things like that. If that's the kind of skating that you are going towards, like really big moves, I would definitely agree that these are a great boot for you.
Hi, my name is Leah, aka iPower Girl on Instagram. I'm from Austria. I really, really like the shoe. I can highly recommend it. It's a really stiff boot, especially in the ankle area. There's a lot of support, and I love that because I like to do a lot of flips. I have a lot of impact. Like, I fall a lot. I want them to sustain, and so far they do a good job because they are like 4 months old now, and I mean, okay, they're a little bit dirty, but you can clean them, that's super easy. And so far they are not broken anywhere. The heel is still attached to the boot. There are some scratches, but if you take care of them, you can make them go away. These little thingies, yeah, they are a little bit scratched, but they still work. They are not bent in any kind of direction. Yeah, all in all, I really like this boot. I can highly recommend it to you if you want to street skate or park skate and try some crazy flips. There's a lot of comfortable stuff in there. So because the material of the shoe is leather, I have the feeling that the shoe, the more often I skated it, it kind of like became a second skin. Like, It fits now better than in the beginning. It took me around 3 days, maybe up to a week, until I kind of broke them in. But I think if you skate more, they will break in more easily, of course. And now today, if I want them to be a little bit looser, I don't tie them that much, that tight. And if I do some crazy flips, I tie them really, really strong, really, really tight, and yeah, well, I lace them really tight. Yeah, so I really love this shoe, this boot. I can highly recommend it. Thanks for having me in your video. Bye.
If you are more of like a dance or a rhythm skater, there is another skater, Jazz Tot, Tot Lock and Drop It on Instagram. And she has, I want to say the Wifa Deluxe, but I'm not sure. And she hasn't, at the day that I'm doing this today, she hasn't given her review yet, but I know she's planning on doing it very soon. So if I have a link, I will put it in the description. Otherwise, just look at her channel and check it out. Wow, the sun just came out and now it's super bright. So I feel like the theme of this video is me and everybody I know talking about how firm these boots are, because they are. They're probably, for all I know, maybe they're the most firm non-artistic boot that you could get. And in case, if that's scaring you off and you're like worried about how maybe it's too firm for you, I want to remind you that there are, of the Wifa Street line, there's actually three different boots. There's the Suede, the Deluxe, and the Street Extreme. And I have the Extreme one, which is aptly named because it is extremely firm. So if you're thinking like, oh, you like that they're talking about how, you know, the fit or the arch support or the shock absorption, but you're not sure about us constantly saying how firm it is, then maybe you should look into one of the other two. And I can't say this with 100% certainty because I don't have the other ones. What I've heard from people who have all of these is that the Lolly is softer than everything. And then the Suede is more comparable to the Jack, although it does hold up its firmness over time, whereas the Jack does tend to get a lot softer over time. The Deluxe is firmer than all of them, and of course, as you've heard many, many times, saying all throughout this video, the Xtreme is extremely firm. So the TLDW, too long didn't watch because I know this did end up being a very long video, is that the Wifa makes very high quality boots. They come in three different, there's the Street Deluxe, and the Street Xtreme. I have the Street Xtreme, which is good if you're going to be doing a lot of like jumps and flips because it is very, very firm. But that's up to you, because for example, my friend Lisa, who loves artistic skating, thinks it's a nice firmness because she thinks everything else, like for example, Moxie, is unskatably soft. So of course there's some subjectivity there. But if you're like maybe more of like an entry level or a newer skater, you might prefer something like the Street or the Street Deluxe. For me, if I were going to be doing street skating, I probably would have done something like one of those two, because this is a little bit too firm for street skating for me. I like it more for bowls and big ramps. If I helped you make a decision or helped you build your skates, please tag me on Instagram. I always love to see other people's builds.
This show is terrible, something wonderful happens.
What?
It ends.